Life under the midnight sun. Here in the Arctic Circle, nature rules.
We breathe, we live for the reindeer, because the reindeer, they are the ones that are making us survive.
But all this is under threat. The impact of climate change is being felt and seen more in this part of Norway than in most other parts of the world.
The climate crisis is definitely here, and it has started, and it is dramatic already. I can see the forest dying. I can see our river being closed for salmon fishing.
It's also a place rich in natural resources that have made this country very wealthy, and that creates a conflict.
I know how it could be in Hammerfest if we don't have the oil and gas companies there. It will be a ghost city with no industry and nothing.
So the battle for the Arctic is on. We've travelled thousands of kilometres to meet the young people taking on their government, trying to stop further drilling for oil and gas. It's one of many fights emerging across Europe. The wealth of nations versus the health of the planet. Who will win? In the fjords of the northern tip of Norway, climate change campaigners have set up camp, forming their own Arctic Circle of solidarity. They're trying to stop the opening of a mine, which they say would damage this place forever. Ella Marie Heite Ikerson is one of the country's biggest young stars, a winner of their X Factor style competition. She's from the Sami people, an indigenous community, but now fears for their way of life.
There is so much tradition based off of living off of nature and the river and our forests. It's such a big part of who we are and our tradition and why we live here.
These protesters have come from very different parts of Norway, but all believe their country's export of fossil fuels is putting the planet in peril.
I can see basically everyone in my generation and younger than me also being very concerned about the future. We are real people with real feelings, and we are very, very concerned about the future, and we are feeling a lot of anxiety. I do believe that the climate crisis is definitely here, and it has started, and it is dramatic already.
And so when she's not writing and performing songs, 23-year-old Ella Marie is taking her government to the European Court of Human Rights. She argues allowing more drilling for oil in the Arctic will harm young people's future.
I'm really hungry to see and eager to see the Norwegian government be held responsible for their actions and their politics. And I really do believe that Norway has a big part of the responsibility of to solve the climate crisis, because we have been such a big oil producer. Just with my own eyes in my closest environment back home where I grew up, I can see our river being closed for salmon fishing for the first time. I can see the forest dying.
Warmer conditions have attracted moths, which decimate the trees in their path. Trees which would absorb harmful carbon dioxide caused by burning fossil fuels. Scientists point to these as scars of climate change. As we journey through this remote and often breathtaking region, we hear of more people who are fearful for the future. Today we're going to meet someone who's been witnessing an environment in flux.
It's on this side. all the glaciers was made during last ice age about 10,000 years ago. So it's really scary what's happening right now. Until you get to stand down right there.
Oddrun Murata Skimstad sometimes feels she's fighting a losing battle. Her job is to try to protect the environment in Lingen municipality. She's alarmed by what she's seen in the decade she's been living here.
The glaciers has decreased, the winters are getting warmer, the summers are getting warmer, it's more weather, more rain. We don't really know how it will end, so it's quite scary actually, yeah, it is.
Oddrun has told us about a particular glacier nearby. It's a 5-hour hike to get there. But she says once we arrive, we'll see for ourselves exactly what's changed. They call these the Norwegian Alps. This one of 140 glaciers on the Lingen Peninsula. But a place which has been sculpted over thousands of years is now melting rapidly, all adding to rising sea levels.
In 1998, the glacier reached all the way back to here. But in just 4 years, it had retracted to where I'm standing now. And in the years that followed, the ice continued to melt. And you can see what's happened. So much has been lost in just 23 years. A landscape redrawn.
One of my reindeer, his name is Modstjoibat. It's the biggest one in our reindeer herd, and he is like my grandmother actually, very stubborn. He is the boss of the herd, just like my grandma. She is the boss of our district. So I'm just excited to see if we see him today.
Mun kalkkaan iechan muistelte, mun muistel nalks tän naamaa. Mun ammalle inka kaan anna nilstatte logiego.
Singing yoiks, the traditional Sami songs, has helped pass many hours looking for their animals. At 83, Karen Anna is the oldest reindeer herder in the region. Her family have been doing this for 400 years. Something her granddaughter, Anna Katja, is well aware of.
It's our life. We breathe, we live for the reindeer, because the reindeer, they are the ones that are making us survive.
But today, they're not having any luck tracking them down. It's an unusually hot day, yet again. Eventually, they spot that their reindeer have headed way up the mountainside to one of the few pockets of snow, a cool spot of sanctuary in a warming world. This is all Karen Anna has ever known, a nomadic life. This is one of 6 cabins she stays at, depending on where her reindeer have decided to venture.
Det är gärna både sparpin eller kohtan på tjuvis ju lämna stappe. Ja mun kun saavan, että hikat sen uhkaat ennen kuin...
You've been a reindeer herder all your life. When you're with the animals out there on the land, how do you feel? What goes through your mind?
Ja mun on pohtui, kun parakan olla se jänellenäkin. Mun inne lämna sääraa parkkuskoassakin. Ne mun toutten huije watchpas vuoda. Tälle muude kuin viso taht. Mun toutten nuo tälle muu.
But this grandmother of 9 is worried that future generations won't be able to live like this. She's placing her faith in young people, not politicians.
Mitä tahtaa saa mä iti, jos jo manna nuude. Tallet har vissi solo på mig styrer. Eiko, tämä styrer sen majil minua. Ja hei kättäli nu hehti. Tallet ei kun få mig sen olo, mutta välttä nuoreni. Että tällä färdettä hiedä, ja minä puhu hiedä mielestä spillistä luonttu. Ja tällä me tällä mun tauttendana tällä olo, mutta få mig sen olo.
As Anna Katja leaves her grandma behind, she contemplates her own future.
I find the balance quite difficult between the modern and the traditional way of living. So I really like to show the world what we do and what our traditions are, because I think they are very important.
Unlike other members of the family, reindeer will not define her career. She's a filmmaker, but Anna Katja hopes her work can shine a light on the growing threat to indigenous communities.
The world has more need for power, and that sort of takes away the land of the reindeer. And when they do that, the reindeer has less food to eat. They can't grow as big as they should. So I think for reindeer husbandry, the government is the biggest threat right now.
So does she believe her people will survive?
I try not to think about it so much, because it's really like a dark thought. I am a bit concerned, yes, that the Sami culture will die, and the reindeer husbandry is especially very threatened now. But I really do hope that we will get to live in peace with nature and with the reindeer as we've done for thousands of years. Yeah, if I can be just a little bit like my grandmother, I would be so happy with that in future. Yeah.
We're on the move again. Today it will be an 8-hour drive. The scenery looks like it's been here since time began. But everywhere we go, we're told about how higher temperatures are shaping this environment, including here in the Tromsø region.
They say they're already seeing the impact of climate change in the mountains, in the forests, and in their rivers too.
There's a specific threat worrying this marine biologist and his young helper.
We don't want this fish in the river. This is an introduced species, and it seems to now be exploding in numbers. It's a threat for the native salmon, and we don't know the consequences yet, but with its numbers we see in the rivers now, It's scary. It's really scary, and it's really worrying how many fish we see. This is a female.
Pink salmon, or humpback salmon, often carry diseases which are a big threat to the native Atlantic salmons that so many of us eat. Auden has been tracking the migration of salmon for years, and says the temperature of the water is rising, attracting these unwanted visitors.
The danger with this one is that when temperature rises in the ocean, this will have a benefit over the native species, like the Atlantic salmon and the sea trout and all these native species, because they are adapted to cold water. And when you get an increase in temperature, you will have other, like introduced species that are used to this, have a benefit and will outcompete maybe the native species. Mm. And that's what we see now.
And so you're taking action?
Yes. Well, I think it will be hard to stop it, honestly. I think we can't stop this. The numbers are so high now, we can't stop it. But what we are doing now, we try to reduce it. Reduce the number, so at least we get as many salmon, Atlantic salmon, in to you know, so they can spawn without disturbance of the pinks.
The professor is backing the young Norwegian climate campaigners, fighting their government and trying to turn the tide.
What we really have to do now is take action now and start reducing, you know, climate gases so we can at least put the brakes on. I don't think it's possible really to stop it, and I think most scientists agree on that. And it needs to be decision made by the politicians that are not very popular. Because I think the next generation have a better understanding of what's happening. And if we don't listen to them now, we will leave a bad future for them.
And this generation say they're in for the long haul, investing their time and money, travelling around the country to different protest camps. Back at Repparfjord, where they're trying to stop the nearby mine from reopening, we meet someone else taking the Norwegian government to court in Strasbourg.
They're drilling for oil in the Arctic, farther north than ever before, and in an area where no other countries are drilling for oil. So what we've been doing is we've been suing the state, and we haven't been able to win that fight. So we think that by complaining this to the European Court of Human Rights, we might have a chance to stop this catastrophic oil drilling.
23-year-old Mia Chamberlain has been trying to juggle her psychology degree studies with bringing the legal case.
Personally, my story is kind of one built on climate anxiety. I kind of have this overwhelming fear for the future and a massive, well, both like sadness, deep sadness and anger towards having to grow up in a world that's headed towards ecological collapse. And the only way to kind of stop feeling like this is to actually do something. So suing the state and kind of attacking the problem in such a direct, massive way is a way of actually being able to make Norway take their responsibility.
Do you feel that a lot of young people in Norway and elsewhere feel the same as you?
Yeah, definitely. We have absolutely seen this since the school strikes for climate change that Greta Thunberg started, that this like fear has kind of manifested itself in a movement for a whole generation.
Norway's young activists are part of a growing movement across Europe. In the Netherlands, a court ordered Shell to cut emissions after citizens argued the oil company was violating their human rights. And campaigners from Portugal have filed their own lawsuit to safeguard their future physical and mental well-being.
I'm terrified, but the momentum's definitely there, and I hope that a lot more people are willing to take action, and it definitely doesn't have to be illegal in order to take direct action to change the course we're on. But it does depend on the politicians we choose and the politicians that are, will in fact empower to change what the corporations are doing to our planet.
The Arctic Circle is warming twice as fast as the global average, and here in Norway, they're grappling with a paradox. The government says it's at the forefront of an international effort to tackle climate change, but yet it continues to make billions each year from the export of its oil and gas. Really though, all rich Western nations face the same simple question. How much are they willing to sacrifice to prevent the global climate emergency we're being warned about?
It's a really busy time. It's something in the mind of Erna Solberg. She became Norway's Prime Minister in 2013. We meet her on the campaign trail as she makes a bid for an historic third term in office. Under her leadership, nearly all of Norway's own power consumption has become renewable, but she's given out more permits for drilling oil in the Arctic Ocean.
Six young people in your country feel that their future's in jeopardy because of the policies that you've been pursuing. Do you have any sympathy for those young climate activists who really want to take their case to the European courts now? They want Strasbourg to alter the route that you're going down.
they lost very clearly in our Supreme Court. And I don't, as a politician, believe in using the courts to make political decisions for countries. I believe in democracy, not in a legal system that overruns democracy. And I believe that you should vote on politicians based on what you believe. And we believe that we should develop the resources we have, for example, natural gas, which are, in fact, by our view, part of the solution.
A few weeks after we meet, Erna Solberg loses the election and steps down as Prime Minister. But a new government here will be committed to more drilling, at least for now. The oil and gas sector in Norway accounts for more than 40% of the country's exports. Kim's family is one of 200,000 that relies on the production of fossil fuels. He works for the state-owned energy company, Equinor, as an electrician on an oil rig.
I know how it could be in Hammerfest if we don't have the Equinor and all the oil and gas companies there. It will be a ghost city with no industry and no nothing. So for us, it's important.
Many Norwegians do not want to see these key industries undermined. They feel less drilling could make them poorer.
I'm working on an oil and gas station, and probably my children is also going to work at the same place as I do. I have a lot of friends who is older than me. They have children who is working at the same place. It's very important. We don't have any other place to work.
So if jobs were lost and companies were to close, what would that mean for you and your family, your community?
Maybe I have to move through to another place.
Kim thinks people should be realistic and look at the bigger picture. He believes Norway is on the right path.
If Norway shuts down the oil and gas, someone else is going to produce the oil and gas that we don't produce. So, and they are not doing it at a cleaner way than Norway is doing it. That's my opinion. The oil and gas fields in Barents Sea, who is not built out, if you build them out now, it's going to be a clean oil and gas production. Much cleaner than the Saudi Arabia, the Russians are doing. So I think we, if we don't do it, someone else is doing it.
So Norway has tough decisions to make, like so many other countries, and with time running out.